As of June 10th, 2007, 1.13 billion people use the internet across the globe. In 2003, 27% of Americans and 13% of Europeans engaged in digital piracy. The internet has grown to be one of the most popular means of communication. It is also the foreground for a radical new change. At times, the internet can seem like a domain where freedom of expression reigns, and there seems to be no limits to what an individual can do or say. So why is it that the internet has come to be this place where seemingly almost anything goes? Why don't the rules and laws of the real world transfer over into cyberworld? In the early 90s, there is a common assumption in the business world that the internet would quickly succumb to market forces and suffer the fate of so many other media systems. In 1993, the business community changed their tune of that it would easily be able to convert the internet users into compulsive online shoppers and lucrative audiences for advertisers. Yet online advertising and online retail sales have failed to live up to these projections. The internet has now become a question mark for some corporations in the sense that projected behavior and outcomes are not being executed in online material and behavior. We are moving away from a period where cultural transmission and production took place almost exclusively within the confines of the corporate sector and conformed to the logic of market economy. There is a new mode of cultural transmission taking place in which the audiences now have the means and access to productions. Individuals are now unconstrained by the market through the internet and are free to produce cultural products outside the marketplace. So why do the tight reins of capitalism come loose when dealing with the internet? It is due to the fact that capitalism's main functioning tactics cannot be carried over into cyberspace. Capitalism controls society in two ways, by controlling the meaning of symbols and by falling back on established laws to make sure these symbols shine through. The track record showed the unsuccessful attempt by countless corporations to relinquish full control over these two dominant forms of ruling. It is not that capitalistic corporations have not tried to regain full control. The world's most powerful media and entertainment corporations have tried to control content and consumer behavior on the internet. However, these efforts have not been proven successful. So how do online audiences make their own meanings? Culture jamming is usually appropriative in that it uses corporate intellectual property without permission, and it therefore is usually illegal. Its goal is to challenge or destroy all forms of corporate intellectual property. A common figure that is considered to be at the forefront of culture jamming is Barbie. Barbie's body is a capitalistic symbol, and the appropriation of her offers an alternative suppressed symbol, which is mainly executed via the internet. Barbie has been transformed on the internet countless times, from sorority slut Barbie to transgendered Barbie. Barbie maker Mattel has engaged in legal battles over the use of Barbie images, visual art, and websites. A popular case is that of Mark Nappier, who was brought to battle with Mattel over his website called The Distorted Barbie, which featured Barbie digitally reshaped to mimic media icons. After Nappier received a legal threat from Mattel, he changed all his Barbie images on the website, but not before a group of artists duplicated them and recirculated them on the web. For every appropriated image or website parody, Mattel's lawyers have managed to remove from the web, others appear in its place. It is clear through actions by large capitalistic corporations such as Mattel, who produce meanings with their products, are failing to do so on two fronts: the inability to maintain established symbols and their meanings, as well as ensuring these symbols stay intact through legal methods. Another major corporation that is unable to apply complete control in cyberspace is the music industry. Less than 2 years after the popular peer-to-peer file-sharing program Napster was shut down, online consumers were pirating 3 billion songs, software programs, books, games, and television shows each month through new file-sharing programs such as Kazaa. By summer 2004, the recording industry had filed over 3,000 copyright infringement lawsuits against individual downloaders, including children. However, these lawsuits had little effect on the volume of music piracy within Canada. It is apparent that powerful corporations applying powerful legal methods still cannot maintain a stronghold on the control of the online audience behavior. There are those who argue differently, however. Critics such as Robert McChesney and Lauren Flessig adhere to the normalization thesis, which argues that resistance on the internet will diminish significance as control is reestablished by state and market forces. This, however, seems improbable due to the achieved stable state the internet has already maintained, and the expressive freedoms and unconstrained communicative possibilities of the online audience will not be easily quieted. The internet has become a place to escape the capitalistic society which one finds himself in every day. Capitalism's main functions of creating meanings and governing through laws are unable to be transferred successfully into cyberspace, thereby giving the individual the reins and allowing for material such as transgendered Barbie that is uncensored and uncontrolled by the marketplace. Actions speak louder than words. What does it take to wake up a generation? How can you make someone take off and fly if we don't wake up and shake up the nation? We'll eat the dust of the world.